All right, everybody, we got 10 minutes here with Mr. Ryan Muckenhirn to talk about the, not 308, even though if you're watching, there's a 308 right in front of us, but the 243, correct?
Correct.
Winchestershire, is that
That's correct.
One of theirs?
Yeah.
And actually, I was about to move this because I said we don't want to confuse people, this 308 right in front of us, but Ryan had mentioned that the 243 actually comes from the 308.
It does.
Interesting. And how'd that work out?
You know, the 50s and 60s were an amazing time for metallic cartridges because that's when people started wildcatting or taking existent cases, whether they were military surplus, and turning them into new calibers or taking new calibers and making them into newer calibers. still pretty popular to this day. I would argue that any living ballistician or shooting buff who was around in that time would say that it was the heyday. So inevitably, I'm certain somebody looked at that 308 case and said that would look really good with a smaller bullet in it, and I bet it would go really fast and shoot probably pretty good too.
That always seems to be the case. It's like every time somebody's like, oh, you take this and you neck it down, it's better.
Sometimes.
That's what it seems like.
I mean, better subjective. Let's give some credit where the credit is due. The 308 Winchester is an amazing cartridge and has been so since its introduction. And its spawn have all been really wonderful, too. I don't know of a 308-based cartridge that I don't like.
And 308's had some good kids.
It has, yeah. It's good stock, you know. It's good stock. So, yeah.
So you wanted to talk about the 243 because we brought up, you know, having a 10-minute talk just about a certain cartridge. Mm-hmm. And your reasoning was that you felt the 243 doesn't get enough love.
It doesn't.
Is that because the 243, is that because of its name? I got to ask you this because I've noticed things that, you know, anything that's measured in like standard, like, or that could be measured in standard, like let's say MOA, for example, people are starting to get on this MRAD thing.
Yeah,
it's the
cool
new thing, you know, metric's so much better, even though there's not really a great correlation between MRAD and metric. But, you know, it's like, oh, all these 0.1 systems. Now you have the 6 millimeters, the 6.5 millimeters, the 7 millimeters, all that stuff.
Yep.
The 243 is basically like a 6 millimeter.
It is a 6 millimeter.
It is a 6 millimeter.
It is. It is the standard measurement of the metric version.
Do people look at it kind of like the hillbilly 6 millimeter just because it's in standard?
Now they do, it seems. Which is interesting. You bring up a really good point. For a long time, Americans never adopted metrics, like period, the end, with the exception of like the 7 millimeter Remington Magnum. That cartridge was introduced. It took off. Everybody loved it. It was the only metric that ever made it. Remington also had a counter to the 243 Winchester. It was called the 6mm Remington. It was doomed for failure, unfortunately, out of the gate because Remington had twisted it to be like a varmint cartridge, not like a big game or varmint cartridge. But
wasn't the 260? Didn't that happen to the 6.5 or something?
Yeah, so that was a little, yeah, the twisting thing was the same thing that happened to the 260, but now the 260 is gaining popularity again.
Yes.
But there has been this interesting reversal in popularity, to your point, especially with the long range community. And I don't know if it's semantics or if it's just happenstance. Metrics now are coming back over standards, and I don't get it.
Well, I shoot MRAD, so I got to shoot a metric cartridge.
That's something.
And so the 243, what's great about it? What do you use it for? What's the thing?
A few things. Actually, a lot of things. I've used 243 for coyotes and foxes, prairie dogs, and targets. I've taken antelope. I've taken whitetail. I've taken mule deer. It is an extremely versatile cartridge. And
so it's got to be, is it a little bit on the smaller side?
It is, relativity? It's the,
because I guess you said it's a smaller bolt than the 308.
It is, yep. So it's a 6mm as opposed to just over a 7.5 when compared to a 308 at 7.62. When we look at weights, though, a 243 is propelling like a 90 to 110 grain bullet on average. And I'd say 100 grain is kind of that sweet spot for big game. Whereas a 308 can, you know, easily push 165, 168, 175 grain projectile. So there's a considerable mass difference between the two bullets.
Mm-hmm.
But if you make the right bullet selection, I think a 243 is a really, really capable cartridge. And it's, I think, been kind of deemed a kid's or a ladies or a beginner's cartridge because of its mild mannerisms. But I think that's what's so attractive to the cartridge or of the cartridge for me, because it is so easy to shoot. You can shoot a lot and not get fatigued, and it's easy to control and wrap your hands around and not let get away from you. Whereas going to the range with a 308 and belting out 40 to 60 rounds in a practice session or in a low development session is fatiguing. It wears you down. And for that, I love the 243. It's flatter shooting than 308 by a considerable margin. And, you know, America's favorite cartridge right now, the 6.5 Creedmoor. If you look at the two on
the Prom
paper,
King.
Yeah, the Prom King, to quote Ian. That was good. Love the cartridge. If you look at the two, the 243 Winchester and the 6.5 Creedmoor, they're really ballistically very similar, even to 500 and 600 yards. And when we're talking about hunting game, that's as far as I'm willing to push that envelope. Like myself, that starts to cross the lines and boundaries of ethical for my skill set. So, you know, when I'm measuring a cartridge and its effectiveness on game, I'm drawing that line at like 500 or 600 yards.
Okay.
And so the 243, the 6.5 Creedmoor, the 308, all that 243 falls really nicely in that same kind of category drop as like the 6.5 Creedmoor would.
Really?
Yeah.
So are you talking in terms of just like mostly ballistically?
Yeah.
There's got to be differences in energy down there at that range and everything. But
The Creedmoor is going to carry it just because it has bullet weight going for it. And, you know, weight and velocity make energy. So put the two together, the 243 is going to fall a little short of the 6.5 Creedmoor, but it's still well within the boundaries of reason. For hunting, like a medium-sized animal, like a whitetail or an antelope or something, out to that distance. That's as far as I'd go with a proper bullet selection on really anything, even if I'm shooting my big 30s. So it certainly fills a gap. I actually have a hunting partner. He shot a 243. I've hunted with him for, probably 6 years now. And he shot a 243 since he was like a little fella. And he's probably in his early 20s now, and he still shoots the same Howa 1500 243. And I have watched him take antelope at the outsides of 300 yards. He's taken mule deer with him. It's a great cartridge. It's all about bullet placement, bullet selection.
Yeah.
And that's why I still own 243s to this day.
How about long-range capability on targets? So let's say you're going out to shoot out to, I mean, is it a grand capable?
Absolutely. You know? Absolutely.
Really?
Yep. With the right bullet. We still got to look at that parent case being the 308 and think about some of the long-range cartridges it has spawned, like the 260 Remington. Well, the 243 is very similar, kind of conversation piece is the 260 is to 6.5 Creedmoor, the 243 is to 6 Creedmoor. So with a 110 or 105 or 115 grain ELD or VLD style bullet, enormously capable. Anything you could do with any of the match 6s and 6.5s, you can certainly do with the 243 Winchester, and it's been around since 1955.
You're making me really kind of want one.
It's a good round.
More and more now.
It's a good round.
I'm starting to wonder, should I have gotten my BLR in 243 instead of 308?
No, I think you should have kept that one 308.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I did, so.
You can get a BLR in 243, though.
You can,
yep.
And it's pretty cool to take down light.
Yep. Good antelope round.
That'd be sweet. Okay, I don't know if this question makes sense. But if you had a choice between the 6mm and the 243, is it kind of a toss up, or is there a choice there?
I mean, there you can get really nitpicky with the ballistics on these things, and you can look at cartridge characteristics and
just like what is the difference, I guess?
Really,
they're basically the same.
It's case shape and length and how they handle longer bullets. So without getting too deep into the weeds, the Creedmoor cartridges are based on the 30 TC cartridge. It's like a slightly shorter, square, perhaps more efficient version of the 308 case.
Mm-hmm.
So you can get by shooting a longer bullet with the same overall cartridge length, which means it fits the same magazines, which means you're not losing energy and velocity because it's a more efficient design. We're not stuffing the bullet so deep into the case. So 243s, you're going to eat up a little bit of case capacity with just seating your bullet, unless you seat your bullets long and you've got the magazine length and actions to do it. For me personally, as a hand loader and as somebody who's owned 243s since, well, I'm 31 tomorrow, so since I was 16, I would not choose the 6mm Creedmoor over the 243 because I'm very well established with it.
Ho, ho, ho.
Yeah.
Now, that's a way to bring it in with 20 seconds left. I feel like, feel like the questions are going to stream in, but I hope they
do. Throw them at me.
Just out of curiosity, too, for you folks out there listening to these 10-minute talks, what did you think about us just chatting for 10 minutes about a cartridge? We'd love to hear your thoughts on that. And if there are any other cartridges that you'd want us to dive deeper on, for example, this one, in this case, Mr. Muckenhirn said he really wanted to talk about the 243 and show it a little love. So that's what we did. But let us know what you want to hear about, and maybe we can make it happen. Thanks for listening, everybody. Talk to you next time.
See ya.